This reading is from the book, The Equanimous Mind, How a 10-Day Meditation Bootcamp Unexpectedly Awakened Me to the Fundamentals of Life and Existence, by Manish Chopra, as read by the author.
Day 8. Emotional Physics. The exercise for the day, if we had managed to arrive at a stage in our meditation practice where most of the body was experiencing subtle sensations, was to attempt en masse sweepings of the entire body in one go. The process being analogous to the free flow of a bucket of water being poured over the head, soaking every part of the body from top to bottom. The incremental steps to fully learn the technique had continued to become progressively harder, and I predicted that it would be fun and challenging to tackle this one. I got into position at 4:32 a.m. for the pre-dawn sit and first went through the sequential survey of the body to get ready for the full sweep. Attempting the free flow was a lot harder than it seemed, not only because of the minimum optimal pace, but also because it was hard to maintain sharp concentration on multiple parts at once and sustain the downward or upward flow at the same time. I tried to manage my pace and found that if I went too slowly, I lost track of which body part I was surveying and where I was heading to next. Too fast, and I was inadvertently skipping past certain body parts. Regardless of pace, I found it hard to include the arms in the full sweep, as it was easiest for the scanning water to flow down from the head to torso, and the arms were left dry as they were resting down on the knees. I started wondering about the placement of my arms in the meditative posture and made a mental note to ask the conducting teacher. I noted with amusement that we were being progressed to seemingly more complex steps in the technique when only a few days ago, I was struggling with just focusing my mind on my own respiration and on observing basic bodily sensations. Trying various things to optimize the entire body sweeping technique, I discovered that one way to maintain the right pace and concentration was to pull my mind's concentration up from the toes towards the head on the in-breath and to push it down from the head to toes on the out-breath. While using inhalation and exhalation was clearly a learning crutch of sorts, I was glad I could employ it usefully to at least experience the technique to sweep the entire body in one go. I promised myself not to get too comfortable with the training wheels and slowly wean myself off of the in-breaths and the out-breaths to manage the momentum of my concentration. The entire hour went by quickly in familiarizing myself with the full body scans. I was beginning to have mixed feelings about the approaching conclusion of the camp. I was happy I would soon be reunited with my family and simultaneously felt that I had hardly scratched the surface of learning and imbibing a powerfully liberating technique. Even if I generously estimated that each day I spent at the camp effectively served to rewrite a year's worth of previous conditioning from my most recent past, I would only go back to the time when I had started my professional career. There was still a lot more life I had experienced in years further past. The ostensibly long 10 days of camp now seemed like a very short period of time to fully soak in the learning well of Dhamma. I remembered that I had initially asked the course registrar through the internet-based registration process whether I could leave a few hours earlier before the course was formally over on the final morning, so I could save a day by flying back to Singapore given the timing of daily flights. I was told that would not be permissible and that I should only plan to register for the course at a time when I was ready to spare the full 10 days. I had reasoned with the registrar over email that departing a few hours early would save me one extra vacation day and allow me to return to work on the first business day of the new year. The registrar had responded politely that in that event, if I had important work commitments that conflicted with the 10-day schedule, I should simply plan to skip this particular Vipassana course and register for another one at a more convenient time. While that response had felt somewhat overly regimented at the time, I felt fortunate to have heeded the advice and moved my return flight to the following day, as I now wanted every remaining minute and hour to stretch out just a little bit longer so the learning could etch more deeply and permanently on my mind. I stepped out onto the courtyard as the morning chants were commencing and sat down to take in the pre-dawn sky, still littered with brighter stars and the waning moon. While I wanted to slow down time to extend the Vipassana learning opportunity, there was a sense of anticipation for things I now felt I had to do when I resumed my regular life. I was looking forward to calling the people I wanted to apologize to as soon as I left the camp. Even though I had experienced an inside-out mental transformation, I hadn't lost my memory of how I would otherwise have felt under ordinary circumstances about apologizing. Typically, I would often have conciliatory conversations, yet stop short of making a clean apology. One that clearly said, "I'm sorry," and didn't also involve a justification or qualifier. Probably because it would be too strong a self-inflicted injury to the ego to accept full responsibility for a mistake. I now wanted to apologize as clearly and directly as possible because the big brick walls of my ego had come crumbling down and a flood of empathy for those I might have wronged had permeated my consciousness. In the past, I would also feel justified in expressing how I felt about something in the name of saying it like it is, without being sufficiently mindful of the impact it would have on those at the receiving end. Reassessing certain such recent situations objectively, despite reconcluding that my read of the situation was often accurate, I realize now how misguided my disproportionate response towards others had been in expressing my concerns or frustrations with them. In the same vein, I used to believe that doing whatever it took at all costs was the hallmark of people who were truly committed to achieving high standards in their profession. Never once did I step back and realize that others, who I would judge as not meeting my standards for excellence, might also care about ambitious results, but also care about the nature of the means used in achieving them. The journey mattered to them just as much as arriving at the destination, while I was too preoccupied with stepping on the pedal to charge ahead harder and faster. Perhaps it was time for me to slow down and appreciate my fellow passengers and simply enjoy being on the road as well. I had conjectured that the menu for the meals in the dining hall might be repeated after a week and was reassured to notice the same item served for breakfast as on the first day. I picked up my laundry and headed back to my room to change out of the track pants I'd been wearing into a clean pair of jeans. As I pulled them on, I found that I had to tighten my belt a couple of extra notches to keep the jeans from slipping down. I had a sense that I might be losing weight because of the minimalistic meals, but the elastic-waisted track pants I'd been wearing had masked the extent of shrinkage in my waistline. My face hadn't revealed the loss of flab as it was covered with a week's worth of unshaven facial hair. Together with all the mental benefits of attending the camp, it felt good to note some positive health-related side effects as well. I was now eager to get to a weighing scale soon, but estimated that I might need to wait until I got back to Singapore because I would be overnighting in a guest house with my wife and in-laws in Mumbai before traveling back, and the odds were low I would find one there. The group sitting after breakfast felt effortless, pain-free, and the most natural thing to do. Until just the previous day, I couldn't wait to stretch my legs out as soon as the long hour of practice was finally over, but I now continued sitting in the meditative posture past the announcement of the short break, as if that was the only thing that made sense to do. The discourses had emphasized that our practice must be nearly continuous in the last couple of days aside from the designated breaks for meals and time set aside for rest. It had sounded like a stretch earlier, but it now seemed like the only logical option given the limited time left at the camp, with my aim to have an indelible imprint of this way of life on my mind. As I continued meditating in the Dhamma hall, the new students were asked to stay back for another checkup because we were nearing the end of the course and it was important that all of us got the essentials of the technique down before leaving the camp. I couldn't help but overhear some of the questions posed by other students while I was waiting for our group's turn. One of the questions was how we would know whether the benefits of Vipassana were truly permeating into our lives. The conducting teacher said that different people would experience a range of different positive changes, and cited his own example that when he first started meditating, his mind unleashed his creativity and improved his memory. Overhearing this, my ears tuned even more closely as I felt relieved and validated that what I was experiencing was not delusional. At this point, I felt comfortable listening more intently to the Q&A with the other students because these same questions were likely on all of our minds, so it was appropriate to draw benefit from the generally relevant interchange. The conducting teacher next addressed a question on anger management and asked the students to mindfully notice incremental positive improvements and not fixate on situations that might still be hard to handle with equanimity. Going a step further and preempting a likely follow-up question about domestic life, he went on and said, Often the wife might say, "How come you still get angry now that you practice Vipassana? Clearly, whatever you're doing isn't really working." And yet, we must carefully assess whether we maintain equanimity in even 1 out of 10 situations that would typically draw ire from us. If so, that would still be a sign of progress, and we must not get disappointed about the other 90%. Slowly, with continued practice, we will become increasingly equanimous in more and more difficult situations. He drew the analogy with the nature and pace of progress India was making as a country. While it was very easy to find fault with everything that still needed work, roads, corruption, population explosion, illiteracy, some of the improvements were distinctly noteworthy: economic growth, relevance on the world stage. He also mentioned that one of his personal role models for equanimous individuals was India's Prime Minister at the time, Dr. Manmohan Singh, whom he described as a man with a penetrating vision to help advance the nation in the right direction. He remained calm even in the most difficult of situations. For instance, when he came under fierce attack for the Commonwealth Games in India, or when his government was at risk of being dissolved because the coalition parties were threatening to withdraw their support. Most other political leaders might have shown some signs of agitation, but he remained relatively unperturbed and maintained a steady focus on helping India to become a more advanced and progressive nation. The conducting teacher counseled us also to self-evaluate our progress in a fair and realistic manner and not feel intimidated by the fact that there still might be a long way to go in order to maintain perfect equanimity at all times. While it was good to have that as a long-term goal, it was important to calibrate incremental progress in a reasonable fashion commensurate with how long and how much we have been practicing. I decided to save my questions for a private opportunity because they were of a more personal nature, and let other students ask their questions when our group was called up. I lunched quickly and went back to my room to think through a few questions I intended to ask at 12:30 p.m. after the formal Q&A session open to all students was over, as I had pre-arranged a private meeting through the server managing the course. I headed up eagerly to the Dhamma Hall at 12:20 p.m. so I might get an extra minute or two with him in case he wasn't meeting with another student, and I could also catch the tail end of the official Q&A period. Ironically, he'd been waiting for me in his sleeping quarters, which also served as his office for private meetings, while I was counting down the minutes to 12:30 p.m. in the Dhamma Hall, waiting for him to arrive there. Another friendly server came to the rescue and escorted the conducting teacher from his room to the Dhamma Hall. Making himself comfortable in his meditation seat, he asked with genuine and caring interest, "Poocho, what do you want to ask in Hindi?" I knew I could do a lot with 25 minutes of one-on-one time and got straight to work. I started with thanking him and Goenkaji and the servers for the gift of creating an environment for me to learn this life-changing technique. As the words left my mouth, I noticed that they didn't feel like a perfunctory thank you, but true heartfelt gratitude, more authentic than I had ever expressed to anyone before. He nodded in acknowledgement and said I was lucky that my wife was a believer in the benefit of Vipassana, as it can be hard to sustain the practice after returning home if the spouse is not supportive, or worse, downright dismissive of the technique. It was as if he had read my mind about wanting his practical advice on how to maintain the continuity and discipline towards meditation after leaving the camp. It was my turn to nod with acknowledgement, and I said that I was beginning to experience a lot of benefits described in the discourses, and also along the lines of what I had overheard from his Q&A conversation with another set of students about unleashing memory and creativity. He then asked me how educated I was and whether I had any training in mathematics. I didn't understand the implication of his question, and also didn't want to sound egotistical about my doctorate in engineering and high interest and skill in quantitative and analytical subjects. I mumbled something to the effect that I had a PhD and mathematics had been one of my favorite subjects in school. My dissolving sense of ego stopped me from adding the sidebar tidbits about my technical skills that I would typically include when such a question came up in the past. It turned out to be a good idea not to harp on my mathematical abilities, because he had asked the question for a much simpler reason. I later reflected on how preconditioned I was, whether due to upbringing and schooling in a hyper-competitive environment or because of my own insecurities, to layer in extra credentials and accolades when asked a simple question about essential qualifications. Perhaps my mind was always in the mode of proving to the other person or clients that I or my teams were well qualified for the job at hand, Or perhaps my years in the US had trained me that modesty was not a valuable virtue in the cutthroat business world in which I operated. He had simply wanted to explain a concept using two orthogonal axes, which is why he had asked if I knew mathematics. It was a fair question to ask because people from all walks of life, from artists to businessmen, were likely attending the course, and they wouldn't all have needed a background in mathematics to conduct their respective lines of work. He then went on to explain that I was moving favorably along a hypothetical horizontal axis of ashubh or inauspicious versus shubh, virtuous or auspicious, which was a sign of progress. He then described the orthogonal vertical axis of ashudh, impure, versus shudh, pure, along which I also needed to embark upon journeying from the bottom upwards. It was a very simple and powerful framing for an important and relevant juncture of where I was and what I needed to move towards in order to be continuously equanimous and happy. I had drawn countless such 2x2 diagrams for my clients and explained how they needed to avoid the lower left quadrant and figure out ways to move into the upper right. It was time I understood the 2x2 grid that was going to help me resolve the fundamental issues of my own life. It was clear that these were two distinct and orthogonal axes, and the conducting teacher had used the perfect framework for this mathematically inclined business consultant to expound on a key concept. I was tempted to ask about his educational background, but decided to stay on course with my questions and also not to take the liberty of inquiring about my respected teacher's credentials, who seemed well into his 80s. I asked next about not wanting to give up my drive to achieve big goals in life. He explained that I absolutely shouldn't give up my dreams and must persist with my chosen line of work and truly excel at it. He gave me his own example of coming from a middle-class family in rural Gujarat and building a decent-sized business with his own efforts, enough to afford a comfortable bungalow in Juhu, one of the more desirable addresses in Mumbai. I felt somewhat reassured that the learnings of Vipassana could be applied within the existing setup of my life and work. He could sense there was more behind my question and went on to say that it was important to not get anxious or upset when we don't achieve our goals exactly as we had expected or wanted them to play out, nor get attached to specific desirable outcomes, versus thinking more holistically about what we might learn when things don't turn out as planned. He further emphasized the importance of being reflective and remaining equanimous when things don't go our way and not to blame ourselves or others in such situations. Most importantly, he stressed that we not mistreat or disrespect others when there is an unexpectedly unfavorable turn of events, regardless of what we might believe about their responsibility in those outcomes. He also clarified that kriya or action is completely different from pratikriya or reaction, and Vipassana teaches and enables us not to react in a harmful manner towards ourselves or others. And yet, it was perfectly normal to continue taking actions that were consistent with one's sense of purpose with a balanced and equanimous mind. I felt in that moment as though I'd been living my life thus far like an inanimate object subject to the laws of Newtonian physics. The third law of motion states, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. The physics of feelings and emotions were slowly beginning to crystallize in my mind. I could see three possibilities in the case of human emotionality when encountered with a stimulus or action. First, respond with a proportional or disproportional reaction, typical for most. Or second, do not respond with any action and remain equanimous. Or third, as a further step, if we manage to remain equanimous, is to respond to all situations with a compassionate mind. It seemed that the conducting teacher could tell that some mental jigsaw puzzle piece must have fit perfectly somewhere in my mind. He went on to say that now that I had understood the practice with which I could rid myself from the vikars, that is, the defilements like anger, fear, lust, greed, dishonesty, etc., in my life, it was time to also turn my attention to address some of my vichars, or underlying core beliefs, perspectives, guiding principles, and values. This is what would help me decondition my mind away from the sensitivities to which I had been a reactive and Pavlovian victim for most of my life. I turned next to the practical question of maintaining an active sporting interest in playing squash, stemming from the fact that we had been restricted to a maximum physical activity of brisk walks while we were at the camp. He explained that the restriction on physical activity was simply to minimize distractions during the intense learning during the 10 days of the camp. He cheerfully encouraged me to maintain my active lifestyle and said that I might even notice an improvement in my squash game. It made intuitive sense because I had seen such a positive change in my general mind-body coordination, which was clearly an essential ingredient in the sport that is often described as physical chess to the uninitiated. As I thought about the improved memory recall I had experienced aside from the mind-body coordination, I also wondered whether continuing meditation might also help me learn and retain Mandarin even faster through the regular lessons I was taking to be more linguistically conversant in the countries where it was spoken and I was frequenting during my time in Asia. Another student had arrived late for the formal Q&A period and was now negotiating with the server managing the private interviews for some precious moments with the conducting teacher before the 1 p.m. meditation session commenced in a few minutes. I still had a few more outstanding questions, but uncharacteristically and surprisingly selflessly, I offered to leave and seek more time later, even though I had been allotted private time until 1 p.m. I was grateful for having been blessed with so many clarifications in one conversation and prepared to excuse myself. As the conducting teacher wrapped up the conversation, he wrote his email address on a paper slip. Handing it to me, he said I could write to him anytime with questions and also promised to make more time for us to talk further before the course was over. As I was leaving, he emphasized the importance of reading about Vipassana and Dhamma in order to maintain the intellectual learning process for the conscious mind to serve as reinforcement for the inner mind, which was under training through the meditative process. Aside from my delight that he had taken enough interest to offer to stay in touch after the course, I was impressed that our octogenarian teacher was fluently internet savvy. I dedicated the rest of the afternoon to practicing as continuously as possible so as to draw maximum benefit from the last couple of days of silent meditation. I started enjoying my sitting so much that I was finding the meditative hours to be more blissful and natural than the other waking moments in the day. Fortunately, I had instinctively been following Goenkaji's advice about attempting complete mindfulness even while conducting other daily activities for the last several days and noticed my awareness level about myself and my surroundings continuing to rise. I was in a euphoric mood during the tea break and enjoying a nice stroll in the garden when I suddenly started feeling some nostalgia towards drinking. It had been over a week since the last delicious scotch on the rocks I had nursed at my friend's wedding reception. It was certainly unusual for me to not drink for such an extended period of time, as either a social or a work engagement would create more frequent opportunities. Besides, I like drinking, so would have naturally craved a drink, although not in an alcohol withdrawal kind of way, in well under a week. As I dug further and deeper into these uninvited thoughts, I uncovered that I wasn't missing alcohol itself. Knowing now that it wouldn't help with maintaining awareness of my mind, it was more the feelings I associated with drinking, the social interchange, the relaxed mood, time with friends, interesting and lively conversation, the ambiance in a nice restaurant, and so on. I realized that I had come to associate all these fun activities with the idea of drinking, as my mind had habituated to experiencing them together. My wife used to ask me in the past when I would insist on ordering a drink the minute we sat down at a restaurant for a meal. How come you can't have fun without a drink in your hand? I was happy and eager to report back to her that now I actually could. Later in the evening session, some principles of life and existence that had become self-evident to me thus far during the course started to fully and more clearly crystallize in my mind. Parts of the evening discourse provided more validation and framing for these thoughts. Number 1. Responding to cravings and aversions leads to mental defilements. This is the most fundamental principle underpinning our existence. As soon as we decide to fulfill some desire, either to grasp or hold on to something, or to try and get rid of something, we get fixated on wanting to see things happen in a certain way. In order to do that, we generate some unwholesome defilement that is rooted in an expectation to achieve a certain seemingly desirable outcome. As an example, even to swat a fly or mosquito that is bothering us, we need to feel at least a small amount of aversion, hatred, or anger towards the insect. Considering a material desire, if we expect to receive a certain performance bonus at the end of a work year, we generate a certain amount, however small, of anticipatory greed in us. In a sentimental context, we can't help but expect some reciprocation when we shower affection on someone in a romantic manner. One can work through the same logic for anything where we become fixated around a certain expectation, outcome, or desire. Number 2. Happiness or anxiety is the difference between reality and expectation or desire. Happiness is the difference between what we observe or experience in the real world minus what we build up in anticipation as the expected outcome. From personal experience, we know that our feelings about the smallest thing depend on the expectation we had at the outset. We often find ourselves somewhat let down when a movie, a book, or a restaurant has been overhyped by a friend and our experience doesn't support the high expectations we had going in. It computes, therefore, that the lower our expectations, the higher the chances that we will be happy with the reality that we experience. On the contrary, very high expectations that are met with average or lower real-life experience lead to negative happiness or anxiety. Imagine a well-deserved and a long-planned vacation being disrupted by unexpected, unfavorable weather or other travel delays. Number 3. All life phenomena in the physical and mental realm are impermanent. No matter how short or long the life cycle, all life phenomena in the universe are impermanent. All events are transient and are always in the course of either arising or ebbing away. It is an illusion to believe that anything whatsoever is permanent. Fame, wealth, health, life, relationships, situations are all in the process of changing or evolving and are impermanent. No matter how confident or hopeful we are of something staying the way it is, it's simply in its very nature to change. The universe is designed with this one intrinsic characteristic of all things, beings, thoughts, emotions, and events. Even how we feel about something, good or bad, is transient and thus bound to change over time. Number 4. Observing reality objectively leads to equanimity. The only way to save ourselves from vacillating between cycles of euphoria and dissatisfaction, driven by things going our way or not, is to observe reality in an objective manner. That is, to experience everything with the knowledge that regardless of our preferential bias, it is impermanent. If we are genuinely and inherently aware and appreciative of this fundamental notion of impermanency, it will be easy to appreciate how futile it is to be attached to our preferred outcomes about life's events. Maintaining ongoing awareness about the law of impermanence in every situation will enable a continuous state of equanimity. Favorable and unfavorable outcomes will both feel increasingly neutral and smilingly acceptable. Number 5. Experiencing reality subjectively leads to anxiety. Conversely to the law of maintaining equanimity through objective observation of a transient reality, if we attach our subjective view to the reality we desire, we receive an immediate dose of anxiety. This is true of the smallest things, from a traffic jam leading to a delayed appointment to bigger ones like wanting longingly and unsuccessfully to have children or grandchildren. The moment we avert or crave something, someone, or a particular feeling, we are left feeling anxious about that situation from the inside. Number 6. Mental defilements cause and magnify anxiety. Engendering a negative thought drives an immediate anxiety response, and sustaining it through negative emotions leads to a magnification in anxiety. This is a corollary to experiencing reality subjectively. Per the first law, once we fixate around a certain expectation or outcome from a situation, person, or event, a negative emotion, however small, gets triggered. This leads to a feeling of anxiety in order to achieve that outcome. An agitated mind will continue to harbor these thoughts and emotions until its desired objective is accomplished. In the intervening time, the sustained negative feelings will magnify the level of anxiety. Consider the instance when you're waiting to hear about the outcome of an interview for a job that you desperately want. The longer you wait to hear back from the recruiter, the more anxious you feel about potentially not receiving the offer to join the organization. The same is true for every other life situation. If you continue to crave or avoid a certain outcome, root cause of mental defilements, you continue to remain anxious. Ironically, no sooner than when one particular desired objective is fulfilled, a new one rears its head because the mind is inherently conditioned to the act of craving itself and follows another similar anxiety-inducing cycle. Number 7. An anxious person makes others around them anxious. Anxiety has a tendency to multiply in an exponential manner and can never be contained indefinitely inside the person feeling anxious in the first instance. My assistant at the time related to this well and had once observed that whenever one of the other assistants slammed down the phone at their desk because they had just had a stressful exchange with someone. Everyone in the office area went quiet and the entire atmosphere would become tense. Interestingly, the troubled assistant hadn't said a word to anyone else about why they were upset, but the unnamed anxiety was transmitted successfully to the three or four others seated nearby. My leadership coach used to say, anxiety has a way of leaking out toxically, and it's the job of leaders to contain their anxiety internally. I was keen to go back to the coach and repeat that I may have discovered a way of not letting anxiety arise in the first place and clip its genesis at the source through the practice of Dhamma, never mind trying to suppress it within. Number 8. Onset of anxiety is always accompanied with some physiological response in the form of altered breathing and bodily sensations. The good news is that anytime anxiety gets generated within us, it is always accompanied with a change, however small, in our bodily functioning, providing us with a leading and sometimes a lagging indicator that we're about to fall prey to our cravings or aversions through the arising of one or more mental defilements. Regardless of any other change being perceived or not, there is always an impact on our breathing when we become anxious. Our breath will change from its normal, unnoticeable nature and frequency at the onset of any form of anxiety. It might quicken or slow down, or it might become heavier or irregular. From personal experience, I knew that my breathing quickened when I got upset, became heavier when I tensed up, was irregular when I felt afraid, and so on. Often, if we notice closely, other sensations like sweating, twitching, palpitations, changes in heartbeat and pulse rate also occur in response to and in concert with anxiety arising from different emotions. Number 9. Anxiety compounds by craving or averting these bodily sensations. As we experience anxiety and its physiological byproducts, if we choose to avoid the seemingly unfavorable ones or crave the favorable ones, our anxiety either continues to rise in the moment or accumulates over time inside of us in some sort of anxiety reservoir, which we sometimes describe as worry. Number 10. Removing anxiety at its source or genesis is only possible by remaining equanimous towards our bodily sensations. It took me a while to deduce this final link for myself in the chain of logic. If it holds that acting to suppress or wanting to sustain a certain bodily sensation leads to growth or accumulation of anxiety, then inversely, maintaining a neutral observational stance about that sensation serves to mitigate and eventually annihilate that anxiety. Even the large reservoir of anxiety that we might have built up over the years through our typical responses can be depleted over time by not providing fertile ground for the onslaught of anxiety induced through continuous life circumstances. While I might have previously known some version of a handful of these principles at an intellectual level, I certainly didn't understand them with such clarity of thought as had come through experiencing them over the past week and the associated introspection about various life events over the course of the last 2+ decades. Whenever I struggled with testing the validity of any of these principles, I conducted either a real-life experiment, a prospective thought experiment, or a retrospective postmortem of events, and found no apparent flaw in the reasoning relative to my own self-observed experiences. I made a mental list of the hypotheses I had confirmed through such investigation and promised to continue to validate or refute these laws of emotional physics when I returned to my day-to-day life. Stepping back from my version of homegrown principles of existence and universal laws of emotions, I thought it might appear on the surface that they advocate an approach to life that runs counter to the notion of being human. After all, most of us typically associate being emotional with being human, and the Vipassana meditation technique prescribes remaining equanimous regardless of situation or stimuli. A deeper look revealed that Vipassana helps with combating negative tendencies like fear, anger, greed, envy, and lust, and I didn't think I would particularly miss these emotions in my life. The difference I saw was that while I would continue to experience all the same ups and downs, compliments and insults, gains and losses, achievements and failures, I could now aim to do so with a sense of equanimity and poise through continued practice of meditation. And I would be doing so not just superficially by pretending to appear calm on the outside with a storm brewing inside of me, as the conscious self can be trained to veil the anxiety, but actually strive to achieve a state of mind that enables equanimity from the inside. Furthermore, if and when I might arrive at this ongoing state of mind, the primary outward emotion that would emerge towards others would be that of compassion, and I couldn't see much wrong with that either. The discourses were becoming increasingly rich with nuances that explained the changes I was experiencing, or perhaps I was imbibing more of the concept because I was more aware and attentive. Either way, the evening's discourse seemed to be tailor-made to help reinforce through intellectual learning what I had intuited through meditative introspection over the course of the last 24 to 36 hours. Goenkaji often elucidated complex topics with analogies, and they seemed to be getting better and better with each passing day. This one particularly hit home. Imagine if a spark, or a lit match, comes at us in the form of an insult or misfortune. If we have a virtual fuel tank inside us filled with combustible gasoline, it will ignite spontaneously and create a massive explosion which will destroy the person who carries the gas tank within, as well as the igniter, the other person, if relevant. This tank essentially represents a sum total of how we have dealt with difficult situations in the past, or have trained and conditioned ourselves to act in such situations. Alternatively, if the same tank is filled with cold water, when the same spark comes in contact with it, it serves to douse the igniter and also remains cool and calm itself. The same is true if we sow a hypothetical seed of mental defilements. The seed would turn into an entire tree at some point and bear fruits of its own, which fall onto the ground with seeds inside, which grow into more trees and eventually forests of such defilements. We need to keep these seeds, which came from our prior conditioning, from the original tree, from growing into new trees by not allowing them to fall onto fertile ground in order to keep our negative emotions from prospering in our mind. The story of one of India's famous goddesses, Pāli, serves as a great mythical illustration to bring this analogy to life. One of her many forms is the angry slayer of countless demons. Legend has it that in her rage towards them, she accidentally steps on her own husband, Shiva, and begins to crush him, and he's shown lying under her feet in various visual depictions. She's also shown to have several hands in which she's holding many weapons and a metallic urn, and is surrounded by countless demons. Her extended out tongue is shown as extraordinarily long and is steeped red in blood. She's striving to vanquish an army of demons who have her completely surrounded and decide to start with overcoming their two chieftains, symbolizing raga, craving, and dosha, aversion. The act of seemingly crushing her husband is symbolic of one destroying their own angels and hurting one's well-wishers when overcome with anger and one's judgment gets clouded. Interestingly, as soon as she would slay one of the demons and his blood fell on the ground, new demons would take birth on that very spot with the same multiplying quality as the ones that had been killed, depicting that heedless efforts to conquer defilements are futile and would only serve to multiply them instead. Eventually, she realizes that the only way to contain the army of demons is to not let their blood fall or remain on the ground. In her desperation to avoid increasing the army of demons that she wanted to vanquish, she starts to lick with her tongue, symbolizing punya, shown extended outward, as much of their blood off the ground as she could, and carries the extra blood in the urn she's holding in one of her many hands. The story is symbolic of working through our own demons of cravings and aversions using self-acquired wisdom to achieve liberation from within. In a later mythical form, the same goddess, having thus overcome her demons, becomes the peaceful Durga and is also referred to as Tara, which means the goddess who pulls others out of their misery. Goenkaji next addressed the natural question that was arising in our minds. So what do we do about our old and existing accumulation of defilements from our past, even as we continue to avoid cravings and aversions in our present and future through Vipassana? It was the day for compelling analogies, so he proceeded to share one about body fuel to propound this subject. If we were to fast for a day, our body would survive using a store of pre-existing resources. If you were to go without food for a week, we would still get by somehow, but weaken considerably. Now, if we continue starving for a month or longer, there will come a point where the body's reserves will exhaust completely and lead to loss of life from starvation. The same applies to our store of old defilements. The only way to rid ourselves of the repository is to not allow new cravings or aversions to arise, and then we would slowly but surely eradicate all our pre-existing defilements as well. Only continuous and dedicated practice of Vipassana can enable this removal, as otherwise the accumulated base of defilements and associated mental conditioning would continue to draw us down like gravity. He went on to explain that there are four types of people in the world. The first, those who have been in the dark in the past and continue to remain so, either by choice or due to circumstances. In their ignorance, they continue blind followership of traditional norms and religious rituals as their means for salvation without seeking the actual truth firsthand. This group also continues to perpetuate their own cycle of misery through heedlessness and unwholesome actions. The second, those who are moving from light towards darkness. These were fortunate enough to have a good past and or present, but were now moving towards a life of self-orientation and ignorance. Thus, they start gaining too much ego, pride, wealth, or fame and beginning to treat others in a despising or condescending way because they start believing that their approach or thinking is superior and expect others to follow their wishes. These people thus do not possess true knowledge or punya, the truth which is discovered through self-experience. A third category of people moving from darkness towards light is those who are ignorant or unfortunate in the past but now have found punya and are now on their path to salvation through methodical removal of mental defilements. Finally, those who are fortunate to possess punya and are now applying their stature and means to further themselves and others on the path of Dhamma. These people are moving within brightness and propelling themselves and others forward. There were certainly elements in the second category that had applied to me in the past, especially the part about thinking my approach was supreme and working to convince others about it. Having had a glimpse of Panya at the camp, I knew I had been living in an area of darkness as it pertained to having an inside-out understanding of life's fundamentals. Goenkaji remarked that it was unwise or unlucky to be in the first two categories. I was a good candidate to be in the third category and was now becoming motivated to hopefully move to the fourth one at some point and start helping others with this fortunate discovery I had made. He explained that it was important on this rare occasion to be appropriately selfish about learning the fundamentals of life so we could help ourselves as well as others through a more meritorious approach. He narrated a story from the Buddha's lifetime when a famous merchant, born Sudatta and popularly known as Anath Pindika for his charitable giving to the underprivileged, from the Savatthi region, who had benefited considerably from Vipassana, pleaded with Buddha to travel to his region and teach meditation to the local residents. Buddha agreed and asked him to look for a suitable location that would provide the right environment for learning. The perfect parcel of land to set up the camp, story has it, was a large private leisure garden that belonged to a local prince, Jeta. The merchant got an audience, but the prince dismissed the prospect of selling the land out of hand, citing it as his personal recreational property and thus not for sale, as was an invaluable asset to him. The merchant insisted that the prince name a price, any price, to part with the chosen plot of land. Thinking to discourage the overly zealous merchant from this improbable transaction, the prince said that he would sell the land if he received enough gold coins to literally cover the entire parcel of land with gold. The merchant agreed instantly without any hesitation. The prince was surprised but had to agree to hold up his end of the bargain because the law of the land legislated that the seller had to part with his asset if the buyer agreed to pay the seller's named price. The merchant went off and sold off enough other assets and started laying out gold coins on the parcel of land with the proceeds. The prince had hoped that the merchant could hardly be serious about the agreement, would not follow through on his commitment to pay with gold for a plot of land that was worth a lot less, and was flabbergasted to see the merchant was intent about upholding the deal. When the prince asked in complete astonishment about his willingness to overspend for that particular piece of land, the merchant smilingly explained that it was no ordinary land and it was especially chosen to be the site for a tapo bhumi, a meditation campsite where the Buddha himself was going to teach Vipassana. The merchant went on to convey that it would be worth all of the money he had and even more if even one person could benefit from the liberating meditation technique. Witnessing the inspiration of the merchant, the prince agreed to contribute the rest of the price beyond the gold with which the merchant had already paved a portion of the land. He encouraged the merchant to complete the project to build the Vipassana campsite, which became the popular Jetavan or Jeta's Grove monastery. Inspired by the noble endeavor, the prince stated that he would like to learn to meditate there himself. The story couldn't have better expressed my state of mind. All I could think of at this point was how, not whether or when, I could help bring others I knew, family, friends, colleagues, anyone, to the doorstep of this learning so they could draw benefit from it and I could repay at least a small amount of the debt of gratitude from having received this technique.
Pariyatti, a non-profit 501c3 organization, offers a wide variety of books, eBooks, videos, and audiobooks about the teachings of the Buddha, the Pali language, and Vipassana meditation. Browse our complete catalog at www.pariyatti.org.